one offering be perfected for ever, them that are sanctified, whereof the Holy Ghost also is a witness to us. For after that he had said before, this is the covenant that I will make with them after these days, says the Lord. I'll put my laws into their hearts, and in their minds will I write them. And their sins and iniquities will I remember no more. Now where remission of these is, there is no more offering for sin. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, which he has consecrated for us through the veil, that is, his flesh. And having a high priest over the house of God, let's draw near with a true heart, in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let's hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. He is faithful, that promise. Amen. Sorry, we've got Theresa May with a cough. And the key verse here, verse 19. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus. If you've ever seen a model or imagined what the Israelites were like when they camped in the desert, it'd be a little bit like this church. Because here you'd have the tabernacle, and here will be three tribes, there will be three tribes, there will be three tribes, and there will be three tribes. And the tabernacle was in the middle. And everybody used to look at the tabernacle first thing in the morning to see whether the cloud was on the tabernacle. Because inside the tabernacle area, there's a gate around it, of course, and in the tabernacle itself were two compartments, the holy place and the most holy. And the presence of God was in the most holy place. And when he was present, there was a cloud. There was mist over the tabernacle. A little picture of it there. But the key was this. They were blessed because God was there in the midst of them, but also they were terrified. Because they knew that nobody could come into that tabernacle who wasn't a priest. And so they were able to look and wonder and be thrilled that God was with them, because God was with them, therefore he provided for them, he protected them, he was there with them, he was their only link with survival. If you actually think, they're living in a desert, there's no shops, there's no bank, they can't farm, there's no rain, they got absolutely only what they stand up in. And they relied on this God in the midst of them for the provision of water, the provision of food daily. He dropped it from heaven, called manna. The birds came and died there, and so they had meat. So he's their only link with survival. And so it's a bittersweet thing that this God in the midst of them, he was their survival, he was everything, but also he was a terrifying God. Because nobody was allowed to go into that tabernacle. But the longing, I'm sure, as a kid, for sure, I'd have wanted to go and look over the fence and go into the tabernacle area behind the fence. And then, having got in there, if you're a child, you'd have wanted to get inside and see what's in there. Amen. Wouldn't you? Amen. You'd want to go in that tent. Find out what's all this fuss about. Who's in that tent? You want to go in. And having gone into the first part, the holy place, you think, I'll need to go in that holy of holies to see what's actually going on there. Because people are saying that's where God dwells. And the longing for people was to be as close as they could to this God. A bit like if you're a prime minister or a president. People want to be close to you. Why? Because they want to get something. Okay. The closer they are to the big man, the closer they are to the leader, is they get the favours. You get the droppings of the big person. You'll get the fallout from their position. Amen?
Amen.
They want to get in there. They want to be near God. They wanted to be near God. The same as, you know, often if you've got a superstar, film star, people want to get near them to take a photo and say, oh, I touched his hand. He smiled at me. I mean, when I was 5 years of age, it's the only time I've seen the Queen live. She drove past. She just had her coronation. And I was a little girl. And she drove past in the car and she waved. And I was able to say, I saw the Queen. I don't know what difference it made to me, but I wanted to say, I'd seen the Queen. And people, you know, they want to touch somebody famous, touch someone rich, be near them. Amen? And I'm quite sure the Israelites, although they were terrified of God, wanted to know and be near him. And the awesome, awesome thing about the reading I just read was, by a new and living way,
hallelujah,
we can go into the holiest place by the blood of Jesus.
Amen.
The blood of Jesus made it possible to have no more fence, no more restriction, no more you're not the right person, no more you're not the right tribe, no more you can't come in. By the blood of Jesus, when he died on the cross, the veil in the tabernacle and the temple, because inside was a huge curtain, stopping people going in, stopping people. You couldn't approach God. That curtain tore in two bits and everyone could go in.
Amen.
By the blood of Jesus.
Amen.
And that's the only way. And I can't elaborate on all the scripture, but it's the blood of Jesus that gave us a way to come into the presence of the living God, not just to come, but to come with boldness, to come with confidence. And why do people want to get near big people? Why an apple model? Sacrifices are made all the time. There's an altar here. This one. It's big. What was it for? All day, every day, the priests are making sacrifices. People to bring a goat, they bring a lamb, they bring a pigeon, they bring a cow. And all day long they're burning, burning, burning to try to appease God. And that sacrifice, it just covered up their sin temporarily. Just covered it up. Didn't take it away. The example I often use is we use perfume and deodorant to cover up smell, to cover up that we're dirty. You know, I just put more perfume. But really underneath you're dirty. And the Israelites and every religion in the world that's tried to appease God, you're covering up sin. It doesn't take it away. You're the same rotten person underneath. You've got the same rotten heart, the same rotten mind, the same rotten desires. And you try and get rid of it by doing something. You can't. It's not possible. The sin is taken away by the blood of Jesus. Why Jesus? He's the Son of God. It was the blood of God's own Son. And his blood was acceptable because it was holy, because he was sinless. And he's the only man who ever sinned, who ever was born, who didn't sin. The only man who never rebelled against God. The only one who stayed holy all his life. And therefore his blood was acceptable as the sacrifice for your sin and my sin. And the knowledge of that, that's fact. It's a fact that Jesus died on the cross. It's a fact that the temple veil was torn in half. It's fact. And a change took place. Instead of people trying to be kept away from God, God now has his arms open and says, come to me. You who are weary and heavy laden, come to me and I'll give you rest. His arms are now open for you. But not only to just accept you as a sinner, to accept you and make you his son. See, it's one thing to be a forgiven sinner. That's a certain status. You kind of stay with a slave mentality all your life. A bit like if you've been a prisoner and you've got a criminal record, you've got that criminal record all your life. You know? But when God calls us, he wipes out the criminal record. It's gone. And he accepts you now as a son on equal terms with Jesus. Because the Bible says you're a co-heir with Jesus Christ, and those who he justified, okay? He first of all, he called you, then he justified you, made you holy, then he glorified you and brought you to the position of sonship. And you have to be aware you're a son of God. It doesn't happen in any other religion because it's just impossible. You become a son of God with all the rights and privileges and responsibilities of a son. And Jesus is your co-brother, is your co-heir, and everything God the Father did for him, he wants to do for you. That's the exalted position he raises us to by the blood of Jesus. It's very important you understand that because of the consciousness of who you are. You're not just a forgiven sinner. That has been wiped out. You're now a son of the living God. And every promise, as God has said in prophecy today, every promise is yours. Every blessing is yours. It belongs to you. But let me tell you, you've got to get it. Because there's a liar and a thief around this world called the devil. And he lies and he cheats and he steals and he tries to convince you it's not for you, not for the likes of you. Actually, you're not the right gender, you're not the right nationality, you're not the right social class. It's not for you. But God says it is. And you've got to overcome all those mental barriers and claim what is yours. And Jesus says, you know, the kingdom of God suffers violence and the violent take it by force, right? It's no namby-pamby Christianity where you're kind of just, oh, you know, whatever happens. You have got to aggressively take what is yours or you will not get it. Healing is yours. Before Jesus was crucified, they beat him 39 times. His ribs were visible. The flesh was taken off his back. It wasn't for nothing. It was by his stripes you were healed. Amen. He took every sickness and every disease. I don't care what you've got. Jesus took it. Amen. And if he took it, you don't have to have it. One time in India, when I was there, I went to pay my hotel bill. And somebody's paid it. I thought, oh, hallelujah. I'd have been the biggest idiot if I said, no, I'll pay it myself, thank you. Someone's already paid. Jesus has paid for your sickness. And as long as it takes, you pursue the healing, the perfection for your body. That your body to be strong and vibrant, because that's how God made you. And it's a violation of your flesh that sickness and diseases and viruses and bacteria allowed to live in your body. Truly. In 1 Thessalonians 5, the Apostle Paul said that when Jesus comes, he wants to present us faultless before the throne. Spirit, soul and body. Faultless. You don't have to go out of this world sick. You can go out full of life, but it's time to go. And your spirit goes and your body's laid to rest, but it doesn't have to go out sick. Amen. 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 I don't read that Moses was sick, he just went up the mountain. They couldn't even find his body. Aaron went up the mountain. They died full of years, and they died at the right time, and their spirit went out of their body. Hallelujah. Amen. You don't have to die sick. Healing is yours. You have to pursue it. What do you mean by pursue it? You have to see that it's promised in the Word of God. Then you've got to speak the Word of God. And for every twinge and every pain and that, you just said, by his stripes I was healed. Amen. That healing belongs to me. All right? And I don't care how many thousands of people have died of it. I don't have to die of it. Amen. Psalm 91 says, 1,000 may fall beside you, 10,000 all around you, but you will not be harmed. You don't have to have what everybody else has had or got. Because you're in the world, but you're not of it. You're a different species now. You're a son of God. I do not read of Jesus walking around sick. Do you? Oh, well, he can't heal you today. He's in bed. He's sick. You know, no miracles today. The old boy's sick. Is it? Doesn't make any sense for the son of God to be sick or starving. The same as prosperity. It does belong to you.
Amen.
I believe that. I am a child of God. Prosperity belongs to me. I will lack nothing. I have to pursue it. I've got to get over all the poverty spirit. I've got to get over my social culture. I was brought up in poverty in London after the war. I was brought up in a very poor family where every time you wanted something, we can't afford that, we can't afford that, we're not going on holiday, we can't afford that, you can't have shoes like your friends, you can't have this, you can't have that. I was brought up like that.
Amen, Pastor. Amen.
So since I became a Christian, I've got to get over that. And realise that's not true for me anymore.
That's right. Glory to God.
Amen? Glory. So you can't give what you haven't got.
Thank God.
And if you don't realise it, you're never going to bless anyone else. But Jesus was stripped naked. They took his clothes off him. They took everything off him. He was stripped. He became poor that I might be rich.
Amen.
2 Corinthians chapter 8. Look it up. Jesus became poor that I might be rich. And I don't see Jesus hanging around broke. Sorry, boys. No fish today. No bread today. You know, the father's not working today. He's gone on holiday. You know, go home and starve. He fed them.
Glory.
He took the bread, he took the fish, and he fed them. The disciples said, Lord, send them away. They're hungry. You know, let them go and buy something. They said, well, you feed them. Well, do you want us to go and spend £200 on food? What are you saying, Lord? No. What have we got? You know, this is a huge challenge. This is the challenge I have. Building schools or building clinics or doing anything like that, the Lord says you may not have the harvest, but you've got the seed to sow.
Amen.
And in Jesus' hands, he had 5 loaves and 2 fish. All right, that was his seed.
Thank you, Jesus.
And he believed in his Father. Father, I bless this. Will you bless this?
Amen.
Bless this seed.
Oh, glory.
Make them all sit down, and then he starts to give it out. Do you know what? It never ran out. It never ran out till it had to run out. And we might not have the dosh. We might not have it now. But we have something that God can multiply.
Hallelujah.
And you know you have to start. You have to start. It's no good. The world's way is we have a budget. Okay. You know, in 6 months, in 1 year, and they tote it all up, and this is the budget. Well, let me tell you, the world economics has not worked. Because every country is in debt. Their budgeting system doesn't work. This, you know, save it, get it there. Listen, the world system, by the time you saved it, it's gone up. Your money's not enough. We all experience that. You've got a project, you've got the budget. By the time you're halfway through the project, the budget's gone. The money's all gone. Come on, let's be honest. That's the world system. We don't work on the world system. We have to start working God's way, right? And we can because we're a son of God. And the Son of God fed them with small. And we might be small, but we're going to feed them.
Amen.
We're going to do it. Amen? It doesn't matter. Because it's the Lord who multiplied it. It's the Lord, and the Lord is with us. And I'm in the Holy of Holies with him. And so I'm in the very presence of God. I'm in the very presence of his emanation of glory. I'm in the very presence of the living one, the creator of the universe. We're in his very presence. And it's tangible and it's real. And what we set out to do and the seed we have, he will multiply because he's God. He's God. We forget sometimes he's God. He's not man. He's God. And if he can't do it, then he's not God. But he is God. Hallelujah. And by the blood, I'm in that place. Near to the heart of God. Near to God himself. Where he can multiply. He can do miracles. But we have to go after those things and get over our mental attitudes. And also the attitudes of other people. Who want to tell you can't do it. You say, I know somebody died of that. I know somebody went bankrupt trying to do that. You know, what's the matter with you? Why don't you live safe? Why don't you just care about yourself? Why don't you just care about your family? Why don't you just take care of your own and leave the rest alone? Why don't you just live a little cozy little life by yourself and have enough and just have a nice little life? That's what the devil lies to us. But Jesus says, if you keep your life, you'll lose it. But if you lay your life down for me, you'll find it. Because that might seem, and I think in some respects that has been the Christian way, but it has to change. Just look after your own, live a safe little life, you know, no stress, don't push the boat out, why stress yourself, especially in the West here, you've got everything in it. Why bother? Why did the Good Samaritan bother? Why did he get up his own oil, his own wine? Why did he pay the hotel bill? He didn't have to. But the Son of God, Jesus, said, I want you to be like the Good Samaritan. I want you to pay and go the extra mile, particularly for people you've never seen in your life. Do it. Because that's the way the Son of God operates. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us.
Amen.
I love him because he first loved me. I didn't love him until he showed me his love. Hallelujah. And that by going into the Holy of Holies by the blood of Jesus, we become a son of God. We also become actually a high priest. Not the high priest, that's Jesus. But a high priest is an intercessor. It's somebody who stands between lack and provision. And by being allowed in there by the blood, we become a high priest of the poor. A high priest of the sick, a high priest of those who are treated unjustly. We become a priest for them. We stand in the gap between somebody who has no hope, none, and we become their mediator. Oh, that's a good thought, isn't it? You mediate between, because you're touching God. God's got everything, they got nothing. And God can pass it through us. He can pass it through us. Some of those slides George showed you there. You see a man called Salvatore. He was my interpreter most of the time. He's about 50. No, he's 60 now, 61. Right, I met him when he was 48, something like that, 16 years ago. And during the war, he was a scholar. He'd done his degree, he hadn't finished his degree, but when the rebels came to his house, they knocked his house down, they burnt all his books, he and his wife were in the jungle, in the bush. He had four sons, and it was time for his wife to give birth. And she gave birth to a daughter. And he sent two of his boys off to find food. And the rebels shot them dead. Because when I first met him, I said, how many children you have? So he said, well, I've got three here and two in heaven. I mean, there's a statement. You wouldn't get an ounce of bitterness out of the man.
Yes.
He's gone on to have two more sons. Yes. And they're mighty. And he's one of those we helped buy a little house. And I just thought, when I met him, he had this funny jacket on, which someone would have worn like in a cricket club. It was obviously second hand. It's obviously something he got off the street. And they're very dignified people. But, you know, he had trousers, ill-fitting trousers, a rubbish old shirt, and this funny jacket. Okay. He had no hope of anything. Who would ever help him complete his degree? How could he ever get a house? But, you know, you become a high priest like Jesus.
Amen.
Makes you a mediator. And God touched our hearts.
Amen.
We helped him finish his degree in Benin City. We helped him go to Singapore and get his master's degree in missions.
Yes, yes.
We helped him get a house. We became a mediator. That's not highfalutin. That's not, you know, it's reality.
Amen.
The man now is principal of the Bible school. He's a bishop over several areas. He has a house. He has five sons in university. And he's a man of God. And he has status. Hallelujah. Because somebody... And God calls you and me, because of the blood has caused us to enter into the Holy of Holies, we become mediators for others. Hallelujah. And he will become a mediator for someone else. And you're listening to the teaching, when you're going into the holy place, God wants to use you as a son and a mediator for others. Hallelujah.
Amen. Glory to
and to the very glory that you have on you. You perhaps don't realize it, but we carry the glory of God because we're in the presence of Almighty God. We maybe our faces don't shine, but I tell you, as we move among society, as you move among your friends, there's something different about you. They can't work it out. It's the glory from the presence of the Lord, because the blood has enabled you to go in. That's why we're not boring, we're not quiet, we're just full of the majesty of God. And we begin to act with majestic dominion. We begin to act as if we're somebody. But you know what? We are. Hallelujah. Not by force. It's just natural. Natural. You naturally begin to reproduce the attributes of the living God. He's the creator, he's the provider, he's the sustainer, and he takes responsibility. He takes responsibility for his creation, in that when Satan caused man to fall, he took responsibility for giving us a way out. And you know, when we come into the holy place by the blood of Jesus, he makes you a responsible person. You know, the world, often people say there's lacking leadership. Well, there's a few strong leaders, but they're not very nice, are they? All right. There's a lack of leadership. People willing to lead, to take responsibility, to lead the way, to lead people into this and into that. And why is that? Lack of being in the presence of Almighty God. And when we're in the presence of God, you might have been a shy little creature when you're in school. You might have been, I was completely shy, completely self-conscious, never put my hand up, you know, always conscious I was little and we were poor and all that stuff. But when you meet Jesus and the blood, you understand what the blood has done for you, that changes. And you become somebody. Hallelujah. It gives you a consciousness of who you are. And you know, God then expects you to start taking responsibility, not just for yourself and your family. That's natural. We have to become supernatural. We have to go beyond the norm. We have to go abundance.
Yes, yes.
Madness. Too much. Amen. Hallelujah. Too much. And you become like God, abundance, supernatural. I'm trying to teach the pastors that God is an extravagant God. I said, if he wasn't, why didn't he only make yellow flowers? Why didn't he make red ones and pink ones and violet ones? He needed only, if he only gave us what we needed, we'd only have one colour flower.
Jesus.
One shade of green. I mean, how boring that would be. He's extravagant. I said, why did he make these fish that live deep in the ocean with the most gorgeous colours? Nobody sees them. Why did he make them? Why didn't he just make sparrows that are brown and boring? Why did he make cockatoos? Why did he make peacocks with all their gorgeous feathers? Why? It wasn't necessary. Because God is not into the necessary. He's into the extravagant. He's into the beautiful. He's into the too much. Hallelujah.
We bless you,
that's why it's not boring.
You
know? Imagine life with no peacocks, a life with no cockatoos, a life with no pink roses, red roses, just one colour. Daisy, that's all you get is a daisy. Hallelujah. And God, when you come into contact with him in the Holy Spirit, you become extravagant like that. You don't just want to give people what they need, you want to bless them. You want to go over the top.
Amen.
Hallelujah. You know, have you noticed everything's becoming samey, sterile? Kind of all flush and boring. I mean, if you travel to Europe, you'll see it's all grey. It's all grey and there's no extravagance. It's all very clinical. It's sterile. There's no frills. No fancy bits. You know, we've got to, you know, and it's almost like it's just functional. Well, God's not functional. He's fantastic. And he wants us to be like that. We bring the beauty. We bring the creativity. We bring the glamour, if you like. We bring the sparkle. We bring the life. Hallelujah. Which is not just functional. It's funny. It's joyous. It's over the top. Hallelujah. I know China's not like it today, but in the old days, in the days of very heavy communism, you know, I heard that people, either they had a blue boiler suit or a green one, and that was your lot. That's all anybody wore. It's different now, because it's now become global. But I mean, how sad is that? How sad is that? God is a God of beauty, and we become extravagant like him by the blood of Jesus. Amen. Allow him to set you free. Allow him to show you who you can be. Allow him to show you what you can share. Allow him to show you what you can create. An idea.
Hallelujah.
Just to bless somebody. Lord. An idea. Because they come from God. It's acknowledged that most of the technological and scientific advances have come from Jews or Christians. That's fact. That's fact. I've forgotten where the data is, but George will tell you that he's quoted this before. Why? Why has it come from the Jews and Christians? Why? Because they touch God, that's why. And others don't. And that's where it comes from. God has made a new and living way by the blood of Jesus, whereby we come into the Holy of Holies. So you don't have to live a substandard life. You don't. And you need to take that on board and just decide, I'm not going to live at that level. Someone pushed me down. That's their expectation, their little box they put me in. I don't have to stay like that. God has made me for greater things. Hallelujah. Amen. By the blood of Jesus. Because he's washed my sin away. I am not guilty. There's one offering made for sin forever. It never has to be redone. It's over, finished. God dealt with sin in man forever by the blood of Jesus. It's finished. And now he's liberated us to free us. Don't keep living in that consciousness. I know in some aspects of the church they focus on that. And it kept people down. Well, that's not God's focus. It's to come forth in liberty to the manifestation of the sons of God, it says in Romans. The world is waiting for the manifestation, all right, for you to declare and show who God is. You know, if they don't know God, if they don't know Jesus, how are they going to find him? By looking at you. Looking at you. And saying, what have you got that I haven't got? Well, I've got Jesus. I can connect with God. God's my friend. They'd be horrified, freaked out. God, your friend? Yes, by the blood of Jesus. It was necessary for the blood to be spilled. No other way. Declared from the beginning of the Bible to the end, there's no remission of sins without blood. And no covenant, because it mentions a covenant in that passage I read. There's no covenants. No covenant is made without blood. And that's why, if you have an official document, even today, it's often sealed with red wax. White red wax. It's not blue, it's not green, it's red. Because the red, originally, when people made covenant, they used blood. They'd put some blood in a thing and use a pen, and they'd write their signature with blood. In Africa, they have blood covenant, tribe with tribe, using blood. In Asia, in some places, they have blood covenant made with blood. And a covenant is a binding agreement. And God's covenant with us is everlasting to everlasting. It will never fail because it's made with the blood of Jesus. Sealed with the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. But I also teach, and it's true, that covenants made with Satan are made with blood. And wickedness, demonic powers, curses, and all that stuff, it's real. And it's set free in the world by a blood covenant made by witchcraft. And that's why witches, witch doctors, they want something with your DNA on to put a curse against you. Of course, your DNA is in your blood. And often they'll use a chicken or a goat I've told you before, but in India, let me tell you this story of India. An Indian pastor I met, he owned an island called Nagalanka. Barbara was with me on this trip, so she can verify it. In India, one of the biggest rivers is the Krishna. It's in southeast India, and right at the mouth, the estuary is a big island called Nagalanka. And I met this pastor there. We did a crusade for him there, and he owned that island. He was a prawn merchant, a Brahmin Hindu, he was. And he said, I came to Jesus. His mother had a bad heart, so she was very sick. And because they were Hindus, high-class Hindus, and in their house they have a whole shelf of all the gods, they called the priest of one of the gods to come to pray for the mother. And the priest said, oh, well, you need to make a sacrifice to the god, fruit. So because he's a very rich man, he's a Brahmin, they bring a lorry load of fruit, pineapples, whatever you name it, and they chop them and sacrifice it to the god, but the mother was not healed. So they got another god and called that priest, and he came to the house. He said, no, no, chickens. We need chicken blood. So again, he got a lorry load of chickens. And the compound ran with the blood of chickens as they invoked the favour of this particular god. Of course, the mum wasn't healed. Finally, they go to god number three, and this one said, no, no, it's goats. We have to have blood going. So they get a whole load of goats. They kill them all. There's blood everywhere. And the mother's not healed. At this stage, the pastor's sister, he was not a pastor yet, he's a Hindu, said, I think this is all rubbish. And the witch doctor said, shut your mouth. And her jaw shut. She couldn't speak, she couldn't drink, she couldn't do anything. Because he had power from blood. They took her to hospital. They tried to operate to get her mouth open. They couldn't do it. They couldn't even get a straw in. They could not. She couldn't do anything. So finally the hospital released her and said, Sheila, you'll die. They took her home and they laid her outside and she died. And they said, well, we'll leave her body till the morning, we burn her in the morning, because in one day they burn the body in India. Okay? When they got up in the morning, she sat up alive. They said, what happened? She said, I don't know. But during the night, somebody dressed in white stood by me with a lamp and touched me. And I came back to life. And they didn't know who it was. They're thinking, which god was this? Which god has this power? And for many, many months, they didn't know who it was. But they heard then about Jesus, only vaguely. So they thought, well, maybe it was Jesus. So they got a picture of Jesus and stuck it up with the other gods, you see, and made him one of their gods. But months later, a travelling pastor spoke the real gospel. And they understood Jesus is the only God. So they got rid of all the gods. But they had to be delivered of demons because the demons had been invoked through the blood covenants. And snakes were coming in and out of the house. I mean, it was like a zoo. But by the blood of Jesus, the name of Jesus, they got rid of every devil. All the snakes went away. And this man had a wonderful testimony as he became a pastor. And a very powerful preacher, isn't he, Barbara? You met him. All right. But you see, the power of blood covenant was evident. That demons were released. Hallelujah. But thank God, there is a superior covenant made with the blood of the Son of God. And I want to encourage any of you that maybe in your family line, there's been covenant made with Satan. Right? Not impossible, and that would last for 3 or 4 generations, you see. So you don't know what people have done. But you can see the evidence of a covenant with Satan is that there's a pattern of disaster. There's a pattern of curse. There's a pattern of disease. There's a pattern, you see. And when you see that, you can say, oh, there's been a covenant. And just by becoming a Christian doesn't automatically break it. You have to break it with the blood of Jesus.
Right.
And actually tell Satan, I'm breaking the covenant because of the blood covenant of Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. And it will be broken. And that's why we break bread every week. We are declaring the blood covenant of Jesus. Because there are other covenants in this world. There is witchcraft. There are high priests and priests of other gods. They're demons who work under Satan, of course. See? And people don't realize that. They just think, you know, well, this is just my attempt to find God, you know. But you have to break any previous covenant relationships with any other God by the blood of Jesus. Amen. And you'll be free. And your family will be free. And you can do it in a community. Even nations sometimes have dedicated their country to Satan. But the nation has to turn around and dedicate themselves to God. And this is all by the blood of Jesus. Without the blood of Jesus, it's not possible. But the blood of Jesus has brought us into the presence of the living God. And in his presence, we then receive all the blessings and the benefits. And you have to go after them and claim them and take them by force and overcome. Because you see, the fight we fight is the fight of faith. And faith is believing what God said is true. In fact, God said it in two prophecies today about his word. His word is not void. His word is true. In another prophecy, God said, get to know my word. If you want to know what you're entitled to, read the Bible. And if it's in the Bible and you haven't got it, you say, hello, I'm missing something. Right? This is mine. I'm going to have that. And I didn't know about healing in Jesus until I've been saved for over a year. I never knew Jesus healed today. I never knew Jesus baptized the Holy Spirit, because my particular church never taught me. So when I got sick, I'm thinking, well, this is just bad luck, or maybe I've done something wrong, you know, but now I know better. If I'm sick, I'll get rid of the thing, and I rebuke it and fight for the word of God. Amen?
Amen.
You and your family. So I won't continue any longer, but I want to tell you that he's made a way for you to come into the most holy place by the blood of Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
And it's opened it completely to everybody and anybody. Hallelujah.